C'est étrange. Je ne sais pas ce qui m'arrive ce soir. Je te regarde comme pour la première fois.
Encore des mots, toujours des mots, les mêmes mots.
Je ne sais plus comment te dire.
Rien que des mots.
Mais tu es cette belle histoire d'amour que je ne cesserai jamais de lire.
Des mots faciles, des mots fragiles, c'était trop beau.
Tu es d'hier et de demain.
Bien trop beau.
De toujours, ma seule vérité.
Mais c'est fini, le temps des rêves, les souvenirs se font.
Yeah, we're just sort of observing yesterday's election results, which obviously are complex election results. I'm talking about, of course, the vote in East Timor. Not really. Although East Timor did have an election yesterday. I just don't know any good East Timorian music to play. So, but anyway, you'll hear a little bit of French music on the show today. It is Ask or Tell Me Anything, which people have already divined. The number is 888-720-WNPR, 888-720-9677. Not only is it the day after the French election, it's also the birthday of Joe Buck. And I would like to say something. I don't know if I've ever said this. I have no problem with Joe Buck. I don't even quite understand what the problem with Joe Buck is. But I do enjoy jokes at the expense of Joe Buck. And I'm wondering whether that's okay. I'm wondering, I hate to open another can of worms because the whole shopping cart thing was like a two-week nightmare for me. I got a postcard. I think it's in my bag right now. I got a postcard from a guy condemning me. Like, he went to the trouble of sending a postcard. You know, he had to write something on a small square, a rectangle of paper, or affix a stamp to it and everything. So anyway, so I don't want to go back there. But I do want to say that I question my own ethics. If I don't really see a big problem with Joe Buck, but I enjoy making fun of Joe Buck, that can't possibly be right or moral. So there. I have a lot of other things I want to talk about, but then these shows are not called Colin Talks About a Lot of Things He Wants to Talk About. They're called Ask or Tell Me Anything. So I won't talk about what I want to talk about. I'm going to talk about what you want to talk about. I also want to mention, because I don't remember to do it every time, and also things are about to fall off this desk as I reach for them. I have two envelopes from Mr. Karp. These are envelopes from Mr. Karp. Now, Mr. Karp, if we were to review, is possibly the smartest human being I've ever met. But what he does these days, for reasons that only he understands, is to clip things out of physical publications and place them in envelopes, which he has repurposed, and put stamps on them and send them to me and to other people, too. I'm not the only person who gets these. I am the only person who gets these who makes them available to the wider public. All right? But the only way that I can open one of these envelopes is if you ask me to. If you call and you ask me to, I will open one of these envelopes. I'm kind of waggling them in the air in a way that amuses me. Then I will open them. When I first did this, I would like to say that Jonathan McPants, who's producing this episode and call screening and all this stuff, he didn't actually believe I had envelopes that were sealed that I never opened that I was prepared to open on the air. But I am, and I do, and I will, and then I will attempt to discuss what's in the envelope. So there. Okay. Wow, we got all kinds of things. Wow, this is the truly diverse set of calls here. So I'm just going to take the first one on the list. Here's Scott in Wallingford. Hi, Scott. Oh, where's Scott? Scott, where are you, man? Are you still there? Scott. Should I put him back? I guess I have to put him on hold. Scott, try to figure out how your phone works, because I was prepared to talk. I'm going to try it one more time. I was prepared to talk about music in 1972 with Scott. So, and I still want to. Scott, are you there?
I'm here.
There you go. There you go. Phew.
Testing. 1, 2, 3.
I was so worried. All right. So what are we going to talk about?
Music. There's so much heavy stuff in the world. And, you know, I'm a big music fan. And back in 1972, so many great albums came out in the world of rock that they are now celebrating the 50th anniversary of those.
Well, but besides Thick as a Brick by Jethro Tull, was anything else significant released?
Oh, come on.
that was a joke.
Like, yeah, good. Bands like Yes, you know, we had Jethro Tull, as you mentioned, Steely Dan's first album, how about that? Genesis, Frank Zappa was putting out stuff.
He treats his phone call and makes sure it isn't John Dankosky. Because it's getting a little suspicious here. You so far have not you have not named what I believe is probably the best album from 1972. But go ahead, continue if you. I should say also, last year it was like Blue and Tapestry and stuff. So every year there's 50th anniversaries of really good albums.
Yeah, exactly.
But I would say if you have not in this amount of time mentioned music.
Well, wait, you cut me off twice so far.
I'm sorry. I'm terribly sorry. I apologize.
And I'm not reading this or anything. This is coming from memory. Frank Zappa, Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young, Bob Dylan, Jeff Beck, had all these, Pink Floyd. There you go. Now let's hear what you can remember that I've neglected.
Well, I think the only one that I would just insist be included and possibly vaulted to the top of the list is Music of My Mind by Stevie Wonder, which I believe was the pivotal album not only for Stevie Wonder, but maybe for music, definitely for what we had been thinking of as soul music. And it's Stevie kind of taking charge, too, of his own artistic vision in a way that would then play out with a whole series of other different albums. But that was the pivot, I think, away from being strictly a Motown artist and being instead his own guy. I think this is a lovely way to begin. I wish we had some of that music primed and ready to go so that we could play it for people. But we don't, and we can't, and we'll have to continue somehow. We'll have to press on. All right, so we like to get a mix of people on the air, people with X and Y chromosomes, people with two X chromosomes. Anybody's got a T or an L chromosome, that's fine too. But let's talk to Eileen in Norwich. Hi, Eileen, you're on the air.
Hi, Colin. Hi, thanks for taking my call. My concern is a little more serious. It is about what children are doing with cell phones in school. Young kids, even as young as, say, second grade. Now, I don't want you to think about just Norwich. This is several different districts that I know of that children are bringing cell phones into school, and they are older children are sharing porn with other kids. And I know firsthand, from my colleagues, I'm a retired teacher, that this is happening. Now, there's something called an airdrop where kids can get some porn on their phone, and then I don't know if it's just iPhones or what it is, but they're able to send it to anyone like on a bus. This is happening on the buses and also in the classroom where kids can see, automatically. You don't have to click onto it, but you can automatically you can see a porn picture. Now, I think parents need to be a little more concerned about that versus, critical race theory and what books are being read to their children. That's not a concern. It's the cell phones. I think that parents should ask themselves now, how old what is an appropriate age for children to get phones? Well, the answer should be when your child is old enough to see porn, because they will. That's my concern. And I really wish that the parents would in every district would come to their Board of Ed meetings and say, please have strict guidelines about not bringing phones into school, into the classroom. They should be left in their backpacks. They should be, if they bring them into the classroom, which the kids always do, they should be immediately taken away and brought to the office, and, parents should pick them up.
Well, yeah. Also, there are like theater things now where you surrender your cell phone and it gets stuck in some kind of special envelope and stuff, and then you can't get it back until the end. I don't see any reason why there would need to be smartphones or cell phones or whatever in children's hands in the classroom. It is.
Well, I have to tell you the truth. Now, I know that there are high school teachers that are using the cell phones for lessons and so forth. Of course, there should be, exceptions for that. But I'm telling you, it's out of hand. I'm hearing all of these stories from teachers who have seen this firsthand that these kids are just, and you can't control it. I mean, you slip a cell phone into your pocket. The teacher doesn't know it's there. The teachers don't have they can't pat down the kids and see who has a cell phone. I'm thinking about my young grandkids getting on the bus and somebody next to them having a cell phone and showing a picture that somebody just dropped. I mean, this is crazy. It's just craziness. This is what parents should be concerned about.
How old do you think these kids are who are doing this?
I know a teacher who teaches second grade.
Oh my God.
Who's a second grader, brings it in. Yes. And there are half the kids in another. I have another teacher friend in another district. She teaches fourth grade, and half the kids have cell phones.
Well, I was 27 years old before I would have even understood what was taking place in pornography. So this is too young. I think your point is a good one too. I unfortunately think that the people that you're talking about who are worried about, you know, things that might be covered under that Florida law, I think they probably would say, well, as long as it's not LGBTQ porn, it's fine with me. Boys will be boys. But I think you're making a very valid point here. And all right. So I shouldn't give the number. We have too many calls already. All right. So, and they all look kind of interesting. Oh, let's do this one, though. This one, I bet you this one's going to be good. Oh, this is Dave from Lake Como, Ohio, where there's, in fact, a perfect reproduction of Lake Como from Italy.
Absolutely. We're just hoping the toxic algae doesn't get too bad.
Right. No, they shot all those Succession scenes that were in Lake Como, actually, in Ohio. People don't know that.
Yeah, it's cheaper here than, you know, to go to actual Lake Como. So, thanks for taking my call. We've talked before about various irritating conversational tics or affectations, you know, that you're right, they usually go away or you get used to them or whatever. But sort of related to that, for the umpteenth time the other day, I heard a newscaster talking some story about Russia say like three times in the story, Vladimir Putin. And, you know, I think they said, you know, various other things with this hard glottal stop that is something that I just cannot get used to. It makes my skin crawl when I hear it. You know, something is not important. It's important. Or, you know, it's and you know all the words. I'm not sure if John McWhorter has written on this. I haven't come across it. But a friend of mine says that she thinks it's actually regional from somewhere in Connecticut.
Yes, there is a theory. I do know something about this, which is there is a theory, and it's just that, a theory in linguistics, that this did start, believe it or not, in New Britain, in that kind of general region, and that I think maybe factory workers or some other kind of laborers fanned out from there, kind of out towards the Western Reserve and up towards the Eastern Great Lakes, and that it spread in that direction. That there was a very specific kind of New Britain accent that moved out in that direction. I don't know that there's like a huge amount of proof of this, but I did, like a decade or so ago, I remember reading about this, and I'm thrilled that I remember anything from a decade or so ago, because I'm getting stupider and more disconnected from reality. So that's good news. But yeah, I don't know. You know, it is absolutely true. And it is, if you raise kids in central Connecticut, you can pretty much, you know, circle the date on the calendar when they suddenly start talking about kitten and mitten and all this kind of stuff. And I don't know what there is to be done about it. It's infelicitous sounding. I agree.
And if I were a hiring manager, which I am not, you know, I would go, no obscenities, but I would go full Glengarry on them and say, you know, I'm here on a mission of mercy, you know, learn to speak like in a work setting or certainly in a broadcast setting, and I'm not trying to hurt anybody. And doesn't mean someone's not smart or educated, but it's just to my ear, it's an awful sound. And maybe I need to be a better person, but I don't know how, if it's generational or what.
Well, I think it is somewhat. I mean, look, it's somewhat generational and somewhat not. And we should say also, since you mentioned a broadcast setting, I mean, I think one of the things that has to happen, when I came to public radio, which was in 2009, I didn't sound very much like most people on public radio, and I probably still don't sound very much like people on public radio, but I just sort of thought, okay, I am who I am. You're just going to have to put up with me. And I'm sure I do all kinds of things that bother people. I know I do. I hear about it. And I think that's also true. I mean, another person who was kind of like that at the time was Mike Pesca, who was still at NPR at the time, and he didn't talk quite the way everybody else did, and he didn't have that kind of sonorous Robert Siegel, John Dankosky kind of voice, and I don't either. And, you know, now I'm really fascinated to see how audiences deal with Aisha Rasko, who I really am enjoying as the new host of Sunday Weekend Edition. Yeah, that's what it's called. But she obviously doesn't talk like Robert Siegel either. And she has a very specific sound to her voice, which she's, I think, very smartly not trying to alter too much. And under certain situations, she'll modulate into kind of African-American English. And I sort of feel like, well, everybody should try to get used to that, because it is true that what happened when you and I were growing up, that Peter Jennings and Dan Rather and Tom Brokaw, well, maybe Tom Brokaw is a bad example, but people sort of taught us a way of speaking. That was the way of speaking. But America is a much more party color, multifarious linguistic tapestry, and I think, you know, we have to accept that at some point, and it's a struggle sometimes, because we all have these kind of canonical ideas about what's right. I do too, even though I don't sound right. So, you know, I don't know. I would say roll with it, Dave, and just look out at the beautiful lake in front of you. And watch Alexander Skarsgård zooming by for his appointment with the Roy family, and just think to yourself, you know, life is good. Whether people say kitten or kitten, life is exactly as good either way. That's what I would do anyway. That would be my philosophy. Oh, wow, look at all this stuff. So, all right. I don't even know what some of these things could possibly be. Let's find out. That's part of the fun. It's like Christmas and we're unwrapping presents. Here's John from somewhere. Howard's something. Hi, John. You're on the air.
Yeah, hi, Colin. Hey, I'm listening more. John, you remember me from the old days? But I'm here at the bookstore, Howard's Bookstore in downtown Torrington. And so I just want to talk about, inner city retail a little bit as sort of the tale of all cities. But, the thing is that... we really we're struggling in inner cities in Connecticut in controlling our fate. It's this feeling that we don't control our fate, but we're actually a 70% consumer economy. And if you think about that, as consumers, we have all the power.
Yeah, you do. So tell me where you're headed with this. I'm not 100% following where you're going.
Well, where I'm heading with it is that, I think we can agree that not just Torrington, but inner cities on the whole in Connecticut are struggling, to put it mildly.
Mm-hmm.
And then everyone comes up with, pretty intricate, kind of creative, city planner solutions off the cuff type of thing. But what I'm getting at, from experience, I'm at the bookstore right now, Howard's Bookstore. But it really comes down to, customers coming in and buying a book. It's not real complicated, and that's a $7 to $10 expenditure, and we actually control that where we shop. It's not the government. It's not any conspiracy. None of that. It's just where you decide to shop. And so I guess I'm making a little bit of plug to listeners, and a lot of people do. A lot of people really give a lot of thought to how and where they shop. But also, I think at some point we're going to have to be genuinely innovative.
Yes, I mean, all around. Although bookstores, so independent bookstores are a somewhat unusual case in the sense that they began to have to cope with this stuff sooner than a lot of other kinds of institutions. And by that, I mean the arrival of Barnes & Noble, the arrival of the now-departed Borders, the now-departed Walden Books. So these chain bookstores that could do their purchasing differently and do their discounting differently and stuff like that, get themselves installed in malls where everybody was shopping at the time, in other high-visibility places. And so people started to gravitate towards those to the detriment of the independent bookseller. And then, of course, Amazon came along and we really had some big problems. So, but I think ultimately people also do. I look to, here in Connecticut, I mean, we have some, very well-known, successful, starting probably with RJ Julia, we have some really well-known, successful bookstores. And I think people, once the pandemic's really, really, really over, people are going to come back because they're craving the human contact. You cannot have a conversation with someone at the cash register at Amazon. You want to do that, and you want to see the little hand ballpoint handwritten index card that's taped up to the bookshelf that says, oh, well, John from the staff really liked this book, and here's why. There's all those kinds of tactile and visual and sensory experiences that you have when you do shop. And if bookstores do a good job of that, and I think independent bookstores, because they've been living with these problems for a long time, they are more creative, and they will have, you know, folk night there in the middle of the room, you know, and make up some coffee or whatever. I think independent bookstores, in a way, kind of got out ahead of this. And I think also people started to realize what was in jeopardy and started to support independent bookstores. Now, the question is, how far out does that extend? I think we also know we want to go to our local coffee roaster, not to Starbucks, you know, most of the time anyway. But how far out does it go when you need something else? You need something fast. You need a piece of hardware. You need, you know, and so there. But the other thing that you're talking about is the urban experience of walking around from store to store. You know, there's parts of Montreal that I really like just for that reason, you know, that you can walk. There's like a two-block area. I think it's Rue Notre-Dame West, where you're just like one interesting store after another, or Valencia Street in San Francisco, like boom, 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 you know? And so if you like cities, you like walking around in cities, you like the serendipity of it too. You like the idea that you don't even know where you're going. You don't even know what store you're going to walk into or what you might see in that store. And that's its own kind of pleasure. And we have to make sure that we, A, recover it as we become less sequestered, and B, don't forget to love it. Don't forget to choose it. Because it's easy to think, you know what? I just had an idea of something I want. I'm going to type it into Amazon. And really, you're almost talking about a categorically different experience. All right. Why don't we take a break? There's lots of calls. I'll give out the phone number. What the heck? 888-720-WNPR. 888-720-9677.
Remember the words or parts that he saved, or carousel horses, or how the summer behaves, or off in the distance, remember me to cut. I can still hear you. Just as bad.
That's Albert King. It's the second time we played Albert King in less than a week, after perhaps having gone 12 years without playing him. But it's his birthday today, which raises the question, well, was he born under a bad sign or not? I mean, it was his birthday. He's the same birthday as Joe Buck. Also, you know who else... You know who else was born today? Mr. Celsius. Dr. Celsius? I don't know. Is it Anders Celsius? I don't know. Whoever invented Celsius. It's his birthday today. How can these people be born under a bad sign? All right. So anyway, that's all. But anyway, we did play Albert King last week on Sarah Gasparato's excellent astrology and astronomy show. So there we go. All right. It's time to do more of Ask or Tell Me Anything. My goodness, people are calling in about every single thing you could possibly imagine. Let's go to Adrienne in West Hartford. Hi, you're on the air.
Hi, Colin. So I just checked it out. In 1990, February 9th, James Baker, then Secretary of State, promised Gorbachev that in return for his tearing down the Berlin Wall and opening up Germany, NATO would not advance one inch eastward. So we are playing with fire if we let Finland and Sweden into NATO at this point. It's just going to aggravate. It's just going to pour kerosene on that whole disaster that's Ukraine right now.
That's an interesting, I mean, I don't know how binding that promise would have been. It's a promise made to basically a government and a nation that doesn't really exist in that form anymore. So I don't know. I mean, yes, it does appear that Sweden and Finland are going to kind of jointly apply to join NATO. Which is, it's weird that they, it's, you know, I mean, this is a very gendered thing, and I apologize for saying it, but it is sort of true in a gendered way. It's sort of like, you know, if you go out, two couples go out to dinner, the women will always go to the bathroom at the same time. They'll both go to the bathroom, you know? And it's like Sweden and Finland, or Sweden's going, you want to join NATO? Yeah, let's join it together. Okay, let's join together. And obviously, the reason they want to join together is because they just figured out what it means if you're not in NATO. So I don't know. I don't have a strong opinion about it one way or another. But props to you for pulling up that history, because I certainly didn't know that. I didn't know that was ever a part of any kind of conversation. So, Adrian, excellent work on your part. And since we're on that general topic in that part of the world, let's go to Mike in Woodbury. Hi, Mike.
Hi, how you doing?
Good.
So, you know, the big question, I think, is what do we, and by we, I mean, you know, the Biden administration, do if, God forbid, Vladimir Putin should use what they call, you know, a tactical or battlefield, which, you know, a smaller yield, nuclear weapon in the war of Ukraine, either literally, you know, using it on Ukraine, or even if it's just a demonstration, you know, send it out over the Black Sea or something like that. I mean, I'm obviously they're discussing this. They better be, but I can't imagine what a good response would be. I mean, there probably is no such thing as a good response. It's just, you know, which is worse. But you can't do nothing. Sanctions, more sanctions. That's not going to do anything. I mean, but if you do in kind, then you've started World War III. So, you know, what is the solution if he does that, God forbid, which he might, because he's, you know, we're losing the war conventionally.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, it's certainly a fair question. I will say this, that nobody, including me, should make the mistake of saying, oh, Putin will never do X, because Putin has already proven that he is capable of embracing alternatives that would strike most of us as wrong. Having said that, this is not something that currently keeps me up nights, and I'll tell you why. There isn't really, although the idea of testing it over the Black Sea is maybe interesting and a little bit different, but there's really no huge advantage. There's no upside, really, to using a tactical nuclear weapon in Ukraine if you're trying to reclaim Ukraine. And the other thing is, although Putin does seem unbound by almost anything, there are other people sitting at that table. And you know, Lieutenant General Ben Hodges, who was on the Gist last week and I thought said some really interesting stuff, he said, look, they can imagine a post-Putin world. It's coming. There's going to be a post-Putin Russia. And they're not going to let him do anything he wants to do. And this thing that he already decided to do is just working out so unexpectedly badly that, you know, his ability to draw any card he wants to now is probably deteriorated a little bit. So, you know, you sort of think, well, would anybody else in that room be willing to let him do that? And then, of course, we have to ask, that is the question. Although I would point out that if they can't stop him, that puts them in the category with us. Because, as you may recall, and this came up a lot during the Trump era, it really turns out that if the president wants to get the nuclear football and launch stuff, there is literally no protocol for stopping him. We really need to put that in here in America if we're going to worry about Putin. Because we had a guy for 4 years who was not the most stable genius in the world, no matter what he claimed. And we really had no plan. There is, I mean, other than Tillerson and Mattis talking about maybe they would tackle him or something.
Right.
But constitutionally, we have no way of stopping an unhinged president from deploying nukes. So we should also worry a little bit about that at home. The one thing that I will say, as long as you've raised this, because it's been on my mind a bit, since listening to Ben Hodges, is, I think that's his name, that, first of all, I also have to say, not directly to you, Mike, but to the world, that Anders Celsius, it is Anders Celsius. He wasn't born today. He died on April 25th. That's what it was. Anyway, this is what Jonathan McPans does. He looks up all things that I get wrong. Anyway, back to this. I actually think, so Hodges has been a great case for a limited no-fly zone. It's a no-fly zone where, you know, you don't go air-to-ground strike anywhere outside the borders of Ukraine. But if missiles are coming up from the ground, you can hit them. You fill the air with F-35s. They were created to do this kind of air patrolling. And you just say, you know what? Enough is enough. We're tired of you. You do whatever you want to do within the borders of Russia. But if you do stuff in Ukraine, we're going to hit you. And if you fly over Ukraine with warplanes, we're going to shoot those down. Hodges thinks what I just said, that Putin will not exercise a nuclear option, even in that situation. I realize that's a little bit raising or rolling the dice. On the other hand, how long are we going to let this guy write the script? You know, I mean, I grow weary of it. And I think a lot of the Ukrainians are really getting tired of him. All right. 888-720-WNPR. Oh, it just goes by so fast when we do these things. All right. So I'll go over here to this. We'll go in this direction. Here's John in Middletown. Hi, John. You're on the air.
Hey, Colin. I just want to say, first, let me just say, I don't mean this in any kind of what I'm about to say in any kind of stereotypical way. So I sincerely suggest that the community of folks who are anti-gay consider a world without gay artists. For centuries, their art has made life, terrific as far as all the creation, all the art that we witness, that we enjoy in our lives. So a lot of members of the artistic community are gay, and I just can't imagine a world without their contribution. So I would just ask the anti-gay folks out there to think about that, you know, to give pause to, you know, just, you know, what would our world be like without the gay community and their contribution to the arts?
I think that's quite fair. I mean, I think most of the people that we would identify as anti-gay, and there are absolutely are homophobic people. We didn't get rid of homophobia. We didn't fix that problem. It might look like it from time to time, but we didn't fix that problem. You don't have to go far to find it. You don't have to drive out to Missouri or down to Alabama either. You can find it right here in Connecticut. So I don't mean to suggest that that's not the case. But most of them would say, oh, I'm not anti-gay. I'm anti-teaching about it to second graders or something. That's kind of what they say. There's something I really want to talk about, but let me just say this. No, you know what? I'm going to wait because there's so many other people. And because I did say this is a day to ask or tell me anything. This is not a day for me to make little speeches. So here's Alex from Enfield. Hi, you're on the air.
Hi, Colin. So first thing I wanted to say was I really missed the Wheelhouse. I hope you bring back that show at some point in the future. But the reason I'm calling is so I think that Trump, he has as good of a chance as Biden of winning re-election in 2024. And a lot of people I know think that Trump, he'll be prosecuted and imprisoned by that. And a lot of these people have thought that since the Mueller investigation, they keep thinking that someone is going to prosecute Trump and going to end up in prison, and it's unlikely that he'll be indicted, and I don't know how anyone would think they could get a jury of 12 people to unanimously agree when there's a good chance that probably some of them voted for him. So my question is, what do you think about people who think that Trump will be prosecuted? Is it just a pipe dream? And is that also, do they also think that because they are afraid that Trump could win re-election, but they don't want to confront that fear? Thanks.
Well, yeah. So, well, a couple of things. First of all, I don't think you can ever bet the farm on a successful prosecution of Donald Trump. I think it's probably a smaller than 50% chance that that will happen, which, you know, I mean, the law of inevitability says that things do happen when there are relatively small chances. That's how he got elected, actually. Something that there was a relatively small chance of happening happened. So that's how he got elected in the first place. But so he could still get prosecuted on the same basis, I suppose. But I don't – now, you should know that today he was found in contempt of court in New York. He's facing $10,000 a day in fines if he doesn't turn over the records he was asked to turn over. And so, I mean, it's not like nobody ever does anything to him. I don't think that's why he's not going to get reelected. I don't think he's going to get nominated. That would be my guess. My feeling is that his power is waning and that the coalition that he had, it isn't as strong anymore. Now, a lot of that will depend on what kind of primary season this is, who else is out there in the primaries, and whether, in fact, he can get himself together to run in the primaries. So I don't – when I picture 2024, it's weird because right now I'm in the middle of this thing where my class – I have this poli-sci class at a seminar that I teach at Yale. And what we do at the end of every semester when we do this class is we do this kind of war games thing where I divide the class into two different groups and I simulate a fictional campaign and they have to come up with a media and messaging strategy for a particular candidate. So half of my class is currently working for Kamala Harris, who in this mythical fictional scenario has actually been sworn in as president during the current term because of a sudden Joe Biden departure. And the other half of the class is working on the campaign of Nikki Haley, who is also edged out in front of the pack, so that at the end of this, we are getting a woman Desi American president, no matter who wins. But that's a fictional scenario. But I actually think it's going to be a complex field for the Republicans because the Republican Party at the moment is in search of a solid identity. You know, Will Rogers famously said, "I belong to no organized political party. I'm a Democrat." But I think the Republicans are the more disorganized party right now. And the specific area of disorganization could be kind of simplified into Trump versus no Trump. Is the faction that supported Trump and his policies and that kind of identity politics going to control the party, going to control the nominating process, or is it somebody else? Is it a group of people who are a little bit better at kitchen table issues, which I think is what should determine the whole shape of the 2024 election? Kitchen table issues being sort of, I mean, you know, all of this stuff, to go back to some other caller that we had or several other callers we had today, they, you know, CRT and LGBTQ, those are alphabet soup. And the reason you have to eat alphabet soup is I'm sounding like Trump here, is because there's no meat on the table. There's no meat on the table because, in fact, the economy's bad. There's ways in which government can really intervene to help people. And Biden, at his best, was that kind of guy, particularly as a campaigner. Like, you're not having trouble paying off your credit card, or you're not keeping your car for an extra 75,000 miles, your junker car, because they teach CRT in the schools or LGBTQ issues, or because they didn't cancel, you know, Dr. Seuss or whoever they're supposed to cancel right now, or they did cancel Dr. Seuss. I mean, none of that. But when you face the realities of your life every week, every month, how are you going to get things paid for and stuff like that? It's not these culture war issues that determine it, right? It's part of it is whether government has figured out what your true needs are and how to address them, how to help you achieve some kind of semblance of a successful, nourishing, stable existence, you and your kids. So whoever can articulate those issues better, I think, should do better in almost any election, but especially in 2024. I don't think a Trump or a Trump-style candidate like DeSantis should be very successful in that process. I don't think Mike Pence should be particularly successful in that process. I don't think Pompeo would be successful in that process. So they really ought to if they're smart. I mean, they are. They have an identity crisis right now. They have to figure out who they are. They're disorganized. A smarter choice would be a more realistic kitchen table issues kind of party. But they don't seem very good at that right now. They like all this other crazy stuff that, you know, works well on Tucker Carlson. All right, we got to take a break. We'll come back. We'll take more calls.
Les étoiles, dites-moi étoile, pourquoi j'ai vos regards. Les étoiles. Les étoiles, dites-moi étoile qui vous regardera. Volato, la do, la do, la do, la do.
Well, so far this has been fun, and I want to thank in the control room, Dylan Reyes and Kat Pastor are both in there as technical producers. Jonathan McPants is in the other room, which has no name. But it is a room. It's definitely a room. He's screening calls and producing. And I'm in yet a third room. So thanks to all of us, I guess. Maybe not including me. I have to say, it's sort of a weird day. It's, if you're listening to the podcast, well, if you're listening to the podcast, you don't care. You don't care. But it's so it's Monday. I'm about to finish the show at 2 o'clock, go home, and then come back in here at 4:30 to record a show with John Waters. And I feel like you kind of need to be on your game to interview John Waters for an hour. But I believe I will be on my game. And the other way to think about it is, even if I'm tired, John Waters won't be tired. John Waters is never tired. And he's a very entertaining person. So I could probably just lob a few softballs up there and step back. All right. I'm going to go right down this row of calls. I hope to get to everybody. Here's Peter in Wallingford. Hi, Peter. You're on the air. Or you're not. All right. Well, that opens up a possibility for some other lucky person who will be Eric in Cheshire. Hi, Eric. You're on the air.
Colin, I want to get your feedback on a case in Texas, a recent event in Texas, where a woman who had a miscarriage was charged with murder. For having allegedly performed a self-induced abortion. And then those charges were dropped after it was decided that had she committed the act that she was accused of, that no law would have been violated, which I found to be kind of strange. And also, if the Supreme Court decides to overturn Roe v. Wade, what do you think might be the possibility that more of these kinds of cases are going to come up?
Well, I mean, there's 100% chance that will be more cases like that. I mean, if they really overturn Roe v. Wade, I think we're heading towards kind of a modified, limited, Handmaid's Tale scenario where, in fact, I mean, there's a piece in The Atlantic, which I honestly have with me right now but haven't read because I was more interested in the Jonathan Haidt piece about the new Tower of Babel. But it's called The Abortion Underground, Inside the Covert Network, Preparing for a Post-Roe Future. I think what you're going to see, I mean, best case scenario is you get something like that together and, you know, you meet people's needs somehow. I mean, it'll be state by state. You'll meet people's needs as best you can. But I mean, I think what this really points up is abortion is a medical procedure, and it needs to be treated as a medical procedure. It needs to not be done by people who can't get access to a basic medical procedure. And when people do that, you get the kind of result that you're talking about. So I don't know what a post-Roe future really looks like. I think ultimately, because we're an adaptive society, we can make it slightly better than it is right now. The problem with this poor person right now is that she kind of got caught in the DMZ. You know, Roe hasn't been overturned. There isn't really a good plan to deal with. I mean, this isn't a full-blown
plan to deal with reduced or eliminated abortion access state by state. But presumably there will be one. And it's going to mean it's going to be have to be treated as kind of a supply chain problem, too. You're going to have to be able to get people to where they can get abortions and stuff like that. But I don't know. I haven't thought enough about it to be talking intelligibly about it. So but anyway, thank you for your call. Keeping an eye on the clock here. Here's Christine in Greenwich. Hi, Christine.
Hi. Oh, so glad to be on your show. This is a comment again about Ukraine. I just came back from Romania for a few weeks, and people would say, this is how we were living our life from Ukraine, and boom, the missile came and the building was gone. And one of the comments I remember hearing a lot of was, when Ukraine basically became more independent and gave their nukes back to Russia, the U.S. put in place that they were going to protect Ukraine. And the idea, which I'm so happy you're talking about the no-fly zone, really to me seems the most important issue. And I know that Richard Blumenthal, our senator, had talked about that as well. But that seems to be the most appropriate, unless we can put the Iron Dome like they have in Israel over Ukraine as well. But this is just horrible to see. It would be like our living our life and suddenly the missiles are raining down on us.
Right.
Thank you so much for talking about this today.
Yeah. Well, thanks for bringing up some more history. Yeah, you're talking about the 1994 so-called Budapest Memorandum. For the brief period of time, at the time of the dissolution of the Soviet Union, Ukraine was sort of arguably the third largest nuclear power in the world because there was all this Soviet-era stuff that hadn't made it back to Moscow or wherever Moscow wanted it to go. And so when Ukraine denuclearized, there was a memorandum. I think the United States signed it, and maybe the United Kingdom, Great Britain, something like that, signed it, saying basically, yeah, we would protect them. I mean... I'm glad people are doing this, not just on the face of it. People are calling up about these kinds of things. But because I think one of the things that has died in the social media era, in the Tower of Babel era that we are living in, is context. Nobody knows anything except what has happened in the last 48 hours. Nobody knows anything about anybody except what they did in the last 48 hours or what it seems like maybe they might have done, you know, in the last 48 hours. And social media really kind of encourages that and encourages people. I mean, there's almost no way to explain the context of anything on social media either. So to whatever extent people get their information on social media and their beliefs about things are influenced by what they find on social media, you're basically creating a context-free environment where nobody can ever explain anything. You know, and as you get older, and obviously I have gotten older, you become more keenly aware of the fact that you are among a select group of people who care anything about context. Like when I say lately or of late, I could conceivably mean sometime in the last 5 or 10 years. That's what lately means to me. I'm like an ent in Lord of the Rings. But when you say lately or of late in the digiverse on the social medias, it means, you know, within the last 48 hours, maybe. Now, that would be an expansive view of what lately means. Anyway, I dare not take any more calls. I'm so sorry to Anthony in particular, who waited quite a long time, Mudasir, and Peter wanted to talk about dumpsters, and then he wasn't there. Which is like such a dumpster kind of moment, you know? All right. Thanks to everybody who did call in. Thanks to everybody who helped out. It's time for us to go. That's what we're going to do.